Welcome to New Horizons. I'm your host, Sky, and tonight we have a fantastic sampler of snapshots of the fantastic story of how the Valley of Heart's Delights turned into Silicon Valley, the world's capital of modern electronics. Our guests today represent various enterprises to preserve and record this history, various museums. First is Ben Hatfield, an aerial photographer, as was his dad, Adrian Hatfield, an old friend of mine, who's going to show us some aerial photographs of the area when it was a rich orchard land, and of course we all know what it's like today. How are you doing today, Ben?
Doing great, Scott.
Are you ready
Thank
to
you.
Go in a few minutes?
Okay.
Okay. Next we have Liz Nyberg, who is the direct, can you please say your exact title, Liz?
President of the Los Altos History House Association.
And your association runs the wonderful History House Museum in Los Altos, typical of different museums of the various communities between San Francisco and San Jose. Next, we have Don Cojane from the Perham Foundation. And the Perham Foundation used to operate the wonderful Foothill Electronics Museum.
That's right.
Showing the pre-integrated circuit historical developments in this valley,
right,
which were very important and impressive in the history of electronics. And you're in the process, and you will be telling us later about your plans to build a new museum.
That's correct.
Okay?
Right.
We'll talk to you in a few minutes, Don.
All right, fine.
And next we have Karim Tadros from Intel Museum. And I became acquainted with this museum by visiting the Smithsonian exhibition in San Jose about a month ago. And I think the star of that whole show was the Intel Museum presentation, which is traveling through the country.
That's right.
So Karim, you'll be telling us about your museum. So let's start right off with Ben Hatfield. And can you show us some of your aerial photographers? And all of us, please.
You bet.
Ask questions as we go along.
Okay. These are photos that my father took dating back to 1947. And they document they chronicle the development of the Silicon Valley. Here's a picture to start with of Moffett Field. Here's the runway. Look at all this open country here. This is Bayshore along the top. Sunnyvale Packing Plant. I believe this is Mountain View Alviso Road. It is, yes. Here's
Where's
something.
El Camino, Ben?
El Camino is right here. This is El Camino running along right by the packing plant, I believe. Most of it was ranch lands, farms back in those days. I can remember as a kid growing up here. Something my father wrote on the back of this print that I'll show you. Bayshore Freeway, Moffett Field, 1948. Transformation from dried apricot chips to dried silicon chips.
Okay, let's go back to the picture. And we see a tremendous area of orchard land, which is now wall-to-wall condo houses and plants in the heart of Sunnyvale down here, correct?
Unbelievable, yes.
Okay.
Next photo is, again, with Moffett Field in the background. This happens to be Mountain View Airport, and not too many pilots know about Mountain View Airport. It's taken from the east looking towards Moffett Field. This would be 237 going out here. I think the date on this one is about 48. Yeah, this one is 1948.
And this Mountain View Airport is no longer in existence, correct?
It's no longer in existence. When they started flying the bigger planes, they made them take this airport out, as well as there was an airport in Palo Alto. There was one in Belmont, California. There was one in Palo Alto, right near right near Page Mill Road, and I have a picture to show you of that.
And if you look at a modern map today, you'll see about 10 times the density of structures and houses.
Absolutely.
At least 10 times the density.
Yeah. Yeah, I just did a photo shoot of my father's work of Los Altos, covering Main Street, 1947, using the same camera, same altitude, same type of film, just to document his work and reshoot that. So,
speaking of that, could you show that picture of your father and also the one of you as a boy? Okay, this
is my father in the center,
Adrian Hatfield,
and his two. I think this is Bud Brunn, one of his early competitors, actually, in the Bay Area, and this is his photo pilot here.
And can you show the one with his camera, and you as a boy?
This was taken about 1953, I think. This is one of the telephoto lenses, telephoto lens camera Fairchild. We have six cameras that we use, and in the photo plane.
Now, I understand, correct me if I'm not saying it correctly, that you are now trying to shoot as many after pictures to correspond exactly as some of your father's original 1948 or whatever. Shot same angle, same location.
Right, and I'll show you Los Altos, the one that my brother and I just did. This is Los Altos, 1947.
47.
There's a display at the Santa Clara Library today with the before and after of this particular shot. This is the train tracks here,
which is now Foothill Expressway.
Mm-hmm. The old train station. This is Main Street, and I think this is the firehouse here. I'm talking to some of the old timers around that remember this. Here's the Los Altos Triangle.
This is San Antonio Road.
That
correct?
Is San Antonio Road.
Mm-hmm. Old orchard up there.
Right. And this is before City Hall was ever thought of out there.
Now, where is the town crier located today?
I believe the town crier is.
Keep going to the left of Main Street. It's just off the picture.
Just off the picture?
Yes.
On Main
okay.
Street.
Yeah.
And there was you could take this train all the way from San Francisco to San Jose on what is now Foothill Expressway,
that's
right?
Correct. And it stopped off in Palo Alto at the Mayfield train station, and I believe it went across to the East Bay as well. Oh, this is really something. I study these until 2 a.m. sometimes.
We're going to move on to Liz and the History House Museum in Los Altos. Can you show us where it's located, and then we'll go right on to Liz now.
History House Museum is right here.
Okay, Liz.
All right. Thank you very much. We will zoom in to the Los Altos History House Museum, which opened its doors exactly 20 years ago this December. It is set up to be a 1930 Depression farmhouse, was built by J. Gilbert Smith, who was an orchardist, and he built this home in 1905. In 1954, he sold his property to the city of Los Altos, 10 acres of apricot trees, and these were his trees. This picture was taken about 1950. And the city went on to build the Los Altos Civic Center on his property. The house is still there today. We give tours every Wednesday and Saturday afternoon, and we preserve history by having third graders come in April and May, and they all take a tour of the history house. Another way that we like to preserve history is through the use of videotapes, and these are on sale at History House. A Sense of Place was recently done, and the history of Los Altos is also available. This one is interviewing people who have lived in Los Altos for years and years. And so we are trying to capture oral histories from people, and when they're gone, their history will be gone with them. Another way we like to preserve history is with the use of books. And we have a wonderful collection of books at History House. Passing Farms, Enduring Values. This also goes into Sunnyvale and actually all of Santa Clara Valley. Birth of a Town. This is Annie Knapp Fitz's sketchbook of the Los Altos area. She grew up there. And the last book I want to show is Los Altos, Portrait of a Community. This was written by 15 people from the community, the 15 chapters, so it's kind of a community book, full of pictures and of captions. Then History House is under the auspices of the Los Altos Historical Commission. 7 members who are all volunteers. They have been working last year diligently on coming up with our historical resources inventory. This is an inventory of over 120 homes that have historical interest, or they are churches or downtown buildings. We were lucky to get a grant from the state to pay for a consultant to help us set up our inventory. And we will be going public with our inventory later this fall. Homeowners are enjoying having their home landmarked, because if they're landmarked, then they want to make some improvements to their home. They do not have to stay with our ordinary building codes. They have a more lenient set of building codes.
Liz?
Yes.
Under an altogether different hat, you're involved in the preservation of history in a different way. You and your husband are the publishers now of the Los Altos Town Crier newspaper, correct?
That is correct. And all of our past newspapers are archived at the History House Museum, along with the city collection of archives. So they are bound, they're in the basement. They're a wonderful resource for photos and information on Los Altos. Back to the first newspaper called the Los Altos News. I wish I could tell you what year, but I think it was back in about the 20s.
And I understand you're also taking advantage of the technology that we're going to be hearing about in a moment.
Yes, we've put all of our, I should say, up to the last 3 years, we've put the Town Crier on the internet. And that can be accessed through losaltosonline.com.
Okay, now as we move to talk to Don and Kareem about the pre-integrated circuit and post-integrated circuit technology development in this area, which has been sort of the capital, the world's capital of the technological developments, which have revolutionized everything we do. Not evolutionized, but revolutionized. Because even if it's the way we buy a shirt, it's all affected by the manufacturing technology, which is impacted by the computer and the integrated circuit. But and this valley has a rich history. Now, we started with Ben, who's a private citizen preserving history. We move now to a city and an association preserving history. Now, individuals, as you pointed out, are doing so by writing their own biographies and of the history they're aware of. And I've been involved with some people recently at Varian, and there are 2 wonderful books, The Inventor and the Pilot, about the story of the Varian brothers and their development of the radar, the invention of the Klystron tube, development of radar that won the Battle of Britain in World War II, done right here at Stanford and by these people. And then the life of the engineer that started SLAC and headed Varian for 12 years or more, Dr. Edward Ginston. And if anybody wants to hear more information on these, please call the studio here, 415-949-7616. And thank you, Liz. And now can we move on to Don about the old Foothill College Electronics Museum, the Parham Foundation, and the pre-integrated circuit history of the Valley of technology.
It's very easy to study the history of electronics if we follow the development of vacuum tubes and the transistor. If you trace these 2 inventions, all of electronics is displayed in front of you. What we do particularly well, we have a collection of about 5,000 vacuum tubes, and we're going to display about 100 of them next month at what is called the American Vacuum Society Symposium at the San Jose Convention Center. We have a 20-by-80-foot space that we've been allocated, and we're in charge of the history exhibit for the American Vacuum Society, which is principally people involved in vacuum systems, involved in the manufacture of integrated circuits. And that's taken a lot of our time and effort, and it is free to the public. If It starts on the 21st of October, runs 3 days. If you've got time, go to the San Jose Convention Center. You can get in for free. And you'll see lots of exhibits, including our history exhibit. You mentioned before the Varian brothers. I brought a Varian klystron along with me today. This particular klystron works at X-band. It was used, as you said, in World War II as a local oscillator in a radar set. This one has a permanent magnet attached, but that's a typical Varian klystron that was developed originally in 1937 at Stanford University with a grant of $100 from the university.
It has some wonderful stories. Russell Varian, who is the inventor of this, at the time, fastest responding tube that there was that made radar receivers possible, he was a dyslexic child.
Yes,
I know. They thought he was a dumb kid. And as a matter of fact, he went through college, but he was rejected from Stanford University in their PhD program. He wasn't smart enough. So he went to work for the laboratory, and he had just invented this tube, which helped us win World War II and earned millions of dollars over the years for Stanford University.
That's right.
But he wasn't good enough to be admitted to go to school there. Okay.
There's two other things. I'll be very quick.
Yeah.
One is what our new museum looks like at Kelly Park. That we're developing.
Kelly Park and Center.
We're also involved in what's called a consortium of museums, about 12 collections that will be brought together. These are technical history collections that will be housed in that facility.
Okay. Kareem, can you, pardon?
I'm sorry for interrupting.
I have to check your last name, I'm sorry. Tadros, Kareem Tad, I apologize, Kareem.
That's right.
Will you tell us about the Intel Museum and how it is recording the history and preserving some wonderful artifacts of the revolution in computers and technology that the integrated circuit has made possible?
Certainly. I was hoping, Don, I could borrow your vacuum tube.
Sure. This is an old Audiotron from about 1915. Made in Oakland.
As we know that the vacuum tubes were typically large, used for turning on and off electrical circuits, and the world is now spun on its ear and turned one vacuum tube into millions of vacuum tubes or millions of switches, which we call transistors. And Intel Museum has documented these vacuum tubes transition to silicon transistors using a, in the museum by showing the entire process. Here, starting from the basic, somewhat purified silicon, here's a chunk of purified silicon. And
the element silicon as opposed to silicone rubber.
That's
having
right.
Nothing to do with this.
nothing rubber about this. And what it ends up into is a silicon wafer. And on this wafer, we print integrated circuits, and each square, if it's somewhat hard to see, because each inside each square on there's several hundred of them on this one silicon wafer, are about 3 million transistors, and each transistor roughly equates to one vacuum tube. So we've not only increased the volume, but shrunk it down to a size that's almost impossible to see.
So a Pentium chip, which is about as big as one of my fingernails, contains how many transistors?
Just over 3 million transistors.
3 million transistors on something the size of my fingernail.
That's right.
And it's going to sell for $300 or $400 and be the guts of somebody's PC computer processor.
That's right. The processor has become known as the brains of a personal computer. But what's interesting to document here is that the Intel Museum also shows where we started in the valley. We started with items or products called core memories. And these are actually little magnetic cores through which wires are routed by hand. And here, this represents just over 8,000 bits of memory. And today, something a little bit fancier, using semiconductor technology, which silicon is a semiconductor, is a 8 megabyte, which is millions of bits or bytes of information in this little card. So it's, again, orders of magnitude, more information, and much faster in the magnetic core. The Intel Museum shows many of these artifacts and lots of little of literature, little factoids relating to it. It's open from 8 to 5, Monday through Friday, and it's free to the general public. You can also schedule a tour with volunteer tour guides who happen to be Intel employees, such as myself, who take the time out to try to make what this information age has turned into such a complex task or a complex event and something a little bit more manageable.
Is this a SIMS, by the way?
That's right. That is a single inline memory module. Very good.
Yeah, I know. I just put two in my PC at home the other day.
That's right. Okay.
It's incredible and mind-boggling to me to see how something that's smaller than the size of your fingernail, if you look at it laid out, looks like a map of Los Angeles with every single street, every single house, every single chimney on there.
That's a wonderful analogy, because if you would go down at the microscopic level, it is a city on a piece of silicon. Each road that we see, which connects one building to the next, or one city to the next, is a wire on the silicon wafer or on the silicon chip. And if any one of those wires is broken, or any one of the transistors along the path is not manufactured correctly, the whole chip has to be thrown away.
But not only that, in the manufacturing process, you have to sort of take 10 or so pictures of Los Angeles, and they have to superimpose exactly with each other, right?
That's right. It's something...
It's just mind-boggling.
It is. It's something very similar to a photographic process, but it's repeated several times to make each silicon wafer.
And this valley, Silicon Valley as we're now called, has been the world capital of this technology, and I've got to hand it to Intel. You guys have emerged the winners. I remember back in the 60s, the big five early integrated circuit companies were Motorola, Texas Instruments, out of the valley. In the valley, they were Fairchild, National, and Signetics. Intel was just being founded by Bob Noyce, who had invented the integrated circuit at Fairchild, same time Jack Kilby had invented it in Texas Instruments. Today, who's the winner?
Well,
Intel.
Intel's obviously been doing very well with its products. Starting in 1968, as you mentioned, Robert Noyce and Gordon Moore came up with a business plan, which the idea was to build basically a better memory product. In 1971, we came out with a microprocessor, which at that time was designed to do simple mathematical calculations for a calculator company in Japan. The idea was taken a little bit further to make it a general purpose processor. 25 years later, we have a product called the Pentium Pro introduced, and we're just moving onward every year. And inside the Intel Museum, you get to see the history of the evolution of those microprocessors. A lot of the industry, the companies in the industry who've played a part in that have to be commended as well.
Ben, your aerial photography has been impacted by this technology, hasn't it?
Yes, it has.
And Liz? The newspaper business has been revolutionized by the computer?
Well, and we have our whole inventory on a CD-ROM, our historic inventory. Yeah.
But Don, how has the vacuum tube been impacted by...
Oh, there's still lots of vacuum tube manufacturers around. As a matter of fact, we had most of the electronics industry in place using vacuum tubes prior to the transistor. We had television, radio.
Well, the TV tubes today are still vacuum tubes,
right? Oh, sure,
they're
cathode ray tubes. You also have a tube in your microwave heater in your kitchen. It's a magnetron. So there's lots of tubes still in your home.
Okay.
Interesting.
And all this, unfortunately, has done away with virtually all of the orchards. Mm-hmm. But there still are some preservation attempts at retaining some real samples of orchards before they're all gone. And I do want to mention that in Sunnyvale there's a group building a orchard memorial, if you will, museum. Mm-hmm. It'll be at the Remington Avenue Sunnyvale complex, where they have theaters, civic theater now. They're going to preserve a stretch of orchard, and they are building a little museum there. And of course, in Los Altos, there's a tiny bits of orchards being preserved, are there not?
Very few bits, and that's why we're happy to have our apricot trees still around the Civic Center. And that's the thing about preserving history. If we don't do it now with what's still available to us, our children and their children aren't going to have any of these items to enjoy.
Also, on the personal level, while newspapers and microfilm and computer technology is helping us preserve the public news, these stories of what goes on inside companies, how things are invented, and what people have done isn't going to be recorded unless individuals write it down. So I hope you guys are writing your histories and your biographies. And
well, I know Mike Malone, who you probably know from the Mercury and Channel 54, is writing a book about Apple. Unfortunately, the last chapter is changing quite a bit.
Yeah, we don't have it going to come out.
Can't write it yet.
Yeah, it's changing on a daily basis, but he's trying. It should be an interesting read.
Yeah. Well, I'd like to thank all of you for being here. I'm sorry that we couldn't go deeper into your various areas, but if any of you want to come back to a future edition of our New Horizons show, we welcome you, and we can go into depth on some of your
sure.
exhibits. Or
thank you.
Thank you
very much, Ben,
thank
Liz, Kareem, and Don. And please join us next week for another New Horizons.